Okay, so good morning, everybody. Thank you for being here so early. My name is Jose Carvajal, as David has introduced me. Thank you, David. Thank you to the organizers for having me here today in this interesting session. And I'm going to talk about a debate that runs very much deep into Spanish, and let's say al-Andalus archaeology, because it's Spain and Portugal, and a few other people from other countries. But runs very deep into the archaeology of al-Andalus, but I think it also has a lot of impact in other fields of Islamic archaeology, in other geographical areas, and in other debates of Islamic archaeology. And this is, how can we talk about migration and Islamization at the same time without falling into topics that we rather avoid? And I'll try to be more specific as I go on with the talk. So to start with, I would like to remind you that the Muslim center in Spain, in Iberia, sorry about that, 711, and they lasted, they had a political presence there, either with political structure or without proper political structures, but still a very important presence as a minority there for 900 years. And this is, 711 is one of the most controversial dates in Spanish history. And I'm going to talk here from the point of view of Spanish. Apologies to any Portuguese who are here. They might agree with me or they might not agree with me, but here I have to be very careful with what I say. I'm talking from the Spanish point of view. It's extremely controversial. Why? Because the narrative about Islam in Iberia has been, from the Spanish point of view, looked at under the prism of a catastrophe. So the Arabs arrived, they sallied the Holy Cross, and they destroyed everything. And then there was a long period of reconquista and recovery of the Spanish nation. Or from the other point of view, as the paradigm of integration or convivencia, which sees Muslim Spain as something, as the paradigm of an enlightened territory, which, I mean, I have to say I'm more closer to the integration paradigm. I don't buy everything in it, but just so you know all my cards, I'm closer to the integration paradigm. Now, not everything that has been written and said, obviously, under any of these two paradigms or in between, it's historically relevant. But there are several things that can be said, and there are several solid historiographical positions which are found in between these two paradigms, and I'm going to talk about those two in a second. But first of all, can we say something about migration in Muslim migration in Iberia? Yes, we can say actually a lot of things. We have a lot of information. We know that there was a lot of migration. You wouldn't believe it, but a lot of people would say that there was no migration at all. We don't know how many people arrived. Quite a sizable population, at least enough to change the cultural orientation, but we don't know real numbers. Since when? We know it was since the 8th century, and who? We are talking about whole family profiles. It's one of the things that have been said very often in Iberia is that only warriors came. And that was the reason why the cultural orientation of Islam in Iberia was particular. We know now, thanks to archaeology and written sources, that we had all these data are solid enough. Now, about these two, between the two paradigms of catastrophe and integration, there, as I told you, there are some solid historiographical work done, which tries to explain how al-Andalus came to be, how al-Andalus emerged. Because Al-Andalus appeared suddenly when a lot of Muslims arrived into Iberia and they changed the country and they created something completely new. Now, how do we explain the integration, the formation of Al-Andalus? Okay, there are two paradigms. Sorry, I have been trying to avoid the word formation, but I just fell into it. Because actually, the two paradigms of explanation, one of them can be classified as formation and transition. Okay, the formation paradigm will be very much based on the monumental work of Pierre Guichard in 1976, which was Al-Andalus, a book called Al-Andalus, and it established that the Al-Andalus was created from a rupturist point of view. So it was a new society, essentially based on tribal links. Now, Guichard himself tends to be a bit more, when he talks about tribal links, he doesn't tend to be very radical about them. Other people tend to be much more radical when we talk about tribal links. I won't go into that today. The other paradigm that explains it within historiography, it's what has been called transition, which is, it's based on Guichard, ultimately, but it took a lot of ideas from a model of transition from the late antiquity to feudalism, developed by Chris Wickham in 1984 in a very important article, The Other Transition from the Ancient World to Feudalism. And this was adopted by Manuel Azin and Mansa, first in an attempt to create a synthesis of the formation paradigm with other ideas, and eventually it actually came to be something quite different from the original idea of Guichard. So this is why formation and transition are quite different ways of looking at how al-Andalus was formed. It doesn't mean that they are necessarily opposed, as I hope I will be able to show, but they have very different elements of consideration. So I'm going to focus on the transition perspective because I'm going to criticize it. And now I like to say, because this happens a lot in Spain, when you criticize people, that doesn't mean that you don't like that people. It only means that you are in disagreement with these people, but you can respect it. And I do. So the transition perspective mostly based on the works of Manuel Azin and Mansa. We're talking about three works, mainly, actually, 94 and 97 are the same work, a reedition of the same work, but with a lot of interesting additions. And 98 was a new revision of the paradigm under different conditions. So it was a model that, once it was published, was spread widely and had a lot of impact in the archaeology of al-Andalus. This model establishes that there is a transition in between what there was before al-Andalus and al-Andalus. And al-Andalus was mostly formed as a society in between the 9th and the 10th century, depending on the area of Iberia that you look at. And what you see changing is the society changes from a feudal mode of production to a tributary mode of production. The main model of surplus extraction goes from rent to tax, and the political economy, from a varied political economy and not very complex, we go to a very complex political economy with a very good Islamic, a very solid Islamic base. I won't go into more details because we don't know it, but it's a really complex and interesting model. Now, that model works really well when you look at al-Andalus in a long scale. And a lot of people have used it. I have used it myself. And it's really, as I say, it's really useful if you look at al-Andalus from the point of view of the long dwell history. However, it does not necessarily work so well at a smaller scale. So here, for example, I'm showing you a quote from a work of Miguel Alba and Sonia Gutierrez, who are looking in this work, they are looking at the changes in ceramics. Ceramics are going to be very relevant in this presentation from now on, because I'm a ceramic specialist. But they can be used as a model of how material culture is considered under this paradigm. And the interesting element of this paradigm is that material culture in between the 8th century, the period of arrival of the migrants, and the 10th century, which is the period of the formation of caliphate, it's all interesting as a diachronic process in itself. So we are not interested really in what is happening. We're interested in what goes before, what goes after this. This is a very interesting thing because eventually it leads to a very particular consideration of migration, which is, we know that there's migration. We don't deny that there's migration, of course. But at the same time, the changes that migration introduces have to be downplayed because we don't know what those changes are. And we are not interested in those because we are all interested in the transition from one point to the next. So everything that falls in between, we just call it transitional. And we don't have to make any effort to understand what is happening. So this is basically transition becomes a black box in which you introduce materials from one side and you take them from the other side. And they are pre-Islamic on one side and they're Islamic on the other side. And I think that's a problem. But this is not only a problem in al-Andalus. This is actually, if you look at a little bit of bibliography about migrations in the wider field of archaeology, you will find that this is a very usual thing to happen when migration is considered. Migration is a central concept that has been challenged periodically by approaches that emphasize evolutionary or autochthonous development. So what happens here, more or less, it's not exactly the same process, but more or less it's that the concept of migration, the concept of changes introduced by migration is changed, substituted by a black box, which we call transition, that works as an autochthonous development. Now, there are new perspectives in migration. I'm quoting now exactly the same article that I quoted in the former slide. And this new perspective in migration proposes a multi-scalar way of looking at migration. In other words, we have to look carefully at every context, and we have to try to explain migration not as migration not as an explanatory concept. Migration doesn't explain anything, but it has to figure prominently in explanations because it's there. So it doesn't explain anything, but it needs to be explained, and it needs to be part of the models. So now let me come back very quickly to the formation paradigm, and this is just a very quick comparative perspective between the two models. So the transition model looks at the large scale change in political economy. Essentially, it looks at it from the top to the bottom. The formation model looks at the same change, but it tends to look at it from the bottom to the top. The transition period focus, the transition paradigm focuses on state formation and focuses essentially on what is happening at the end of the transition period, 19th century, whereas the other model is very interested in what is happening before that. So in the moment in which the Muslims arrive on that until the moment of state formation. And the transition model tends to consider transformation of material culture from what Hackenbeck would call a unified point of view or God's eye. So we know everything that is happening. Whereas the formation tends to adopt a much more local point of view when considering changes. Okay. So this is why I prefer formation, the formation paradigm. And I'm going to give you a few quick overlook of the research that have been done for a long time, the research on the Vega of Granada. The Vega of Granada in between the 8th century and the 19th century, particularly the 10th century in this case, I can tell because I studied my area. So in the 10th century, until the 10th century, the Vega of Granada was a very fragmented landscape in a lot of senses, religiously, ethnically, from the point of view of tribal groups. And we know that these differences played a role in the cultural development on the Vega of Granada. Now, I cannot offer you a narrative of what was happening, but I can tell you that I looked very carefully at the ceramics of these sites. I was able to tell that the ceramics were divided in four phases. The sequence of ceramics was divided in four phases. And if you look at it from a large scale view, so if you look at it from far away and you look at it, as you consider all the changes at the same time, it all fits very well with the transition paradigm. But as I said, the problem with the transition paradigm is not that it doesn't work. It is that it obscures something, some elements of the process of thinking in archaeology. So, if you look at it from the if you look at the transition, at the changes of the faces in ceramics, they fit very well with political changes that are very relevant for the transition paradigm. But if you look at it from the point of view of a small scale, you can see that actually technical change is not simple at all. You cannot say that in the moment that the Muslims arrive, everything changes. Or you cannot say that in the moment that Muslims arrive, there is a single path of development that is being triggered. What you have is actually a much more complex thing. There is a lot of different paths of development. And they all have one thing in common, which is interesting, is that developments, innovations, tend to focus on the same particular types of ceramics. Whereas there are other particular types of ceramics we can call it conservative types, that tend to remain the same for a long period, and eventually they disappear. But you know, they continue to be made for a century or so, and eventually they disappear. The other types of ceramics, the new innovative types of ceramics, tend to accumulate all the different innovations. Until in the 10th century, more or less, all this innovation coalesces in a single type, and they form as a new tradition of pottery. But before the 10th century, what we have, it's a lot of different paths of development. We have, so in short, in between phases one and two, so more or less in between the beginning of the Islamic period, 711, I extended a little bit backwards to collect some pottery from before, to the 10th century, we have the appearance of new types and forms. We have the concentration of distinctive developments of morphological types in the Vega of Granada, which is actually very useful because we can say that the Vega of Granada was a particular region from a technological point of view. So what you have within the Vega of Granada is different from what you have outside the Vega of Granada. And then we have a proliferation of technical solutions to produce the same types. For example, the same type of cooking pot, the same morphological type, can be produced with different techniques in different areas. And this all indicates that there is a change in pottery, that it's not the result of a single transformation, that there are a lot of different transformations going around in this small area of the Vega of Granada. So how do we explain this idea of multiple development paths, and multiple development paths sustained over a good time, two centuries almost, 711 to 925, two centuries. So I have tried to use two theoretical models to explain it. One of them is the model of middle ground developed by Gosted, theory of cultural contacts. In the middle ground, basically you have two different or more different cultures meeting together, and the meeting of these different cultures, because they are essentially on equal grounds, produces a lot of original new types of material culture. That concept is interesting, but it has a problem. It tends to be very essentialist in terms of the cultures involved. So here we'll be again talking about an Islamic culture and a non-Islamic culture that meet together. I don't like that very much because I think that there is a lot of variety within Islamic culture and within the pre-Islamic culture. So the other concept that is very interesting to consider will be the John Robb's concept of fields of action, which he developed in an article called Beyond Agency. This concept basically looks at the way in which a particular agent develops its work within its field. In this case, we're looking at the agency of potters. How can we explain that potters are suddenly becoming so original? My theory here is that these potters are actually receiving a lot of influences from a lot of different groups that are coming together in this period. So basically, we have to involve the idea of migration to explain these changes that are happening in these two centuries in the Vega of Granada. You have potters producing separately, independently, and we know that they produce separately, independently, that they don't. There is not a lot of trade of pots in this period, but they are taking ideas from each other in different ways. And the fact that they are able to draw and to be so original is because they are exposed to a lot of different ways of doing things. So, as I said, we have to involve the idea of migration. I don't want to go too deep into this, but for example, in 1990, Anthony developed several models of migration that could be applied to al-Andalus. Just to give you a very brief explanation of the three models that I'm considering, way more advanced is the classical model of migration, where people basically migrate as they grow demographically. Leapfrogging is when people make jumps from one place to the other. And streamline migration is a process that is produced after a leapfrogging, which is when people are particularly prone to go to different areas because they know people in those areas. And this will explain in al-Andalus, for example, the formation of different provinces, which happened before the formation of the Maya state. Now, can we consider these models in the Vega of Granada? Yeah, we can consider them, and we can see them at different scales. The problem is that, of course, the written sources are essentially very fragmentary. So we cannot create, as I would love to do, create a wonderful model explaining who came, where they established at this point. But we have enough data to realize that this is actually quite a complex, as a process of migration. So we know that by written sources that we have Berber migrations. We know by written sources and by toponymy, also the Berber migrations by toponymy, that we have different ways of Arab immigrants, and that they came from the north of Africa, but they also came directly from the Middle East, and they also came directly from other parts of Iberia. We have a lot of silent migrations. I mean, we don't know for sure, but it's likely that we have a lot of silent migrations, of which we know nothing about. And we have also, very importantly, backward migrations. So that the people that migrated were not people that lost all contact with the land where they had come from. They will go a lot, very often they will go backwards, and they will establish sustained contact. And we know that this happens with trade, with the peregrination, the Hajj, and with scholars. There's a really good work on the scholars that were emerging in Granada and how they traveled back to the Middle East, and they established contacts with the Middle East. So I'm trying to conclude here. I think that when we look at the early Islamic period, when we look at what is happening in al-Andalus, but I think to a certain extent this probably could be extended to other territories as well, we tend to focus too much on the idea of migration, of transition, to the point that we don't tend to think about the small scale and how migrations actually are a very complex and multiscalar phenomenon. So what I have tried to present here is how an analysis of the ceramics of the Vega of Granada, which I have been doing for a long time now, very long time. But you can look at the same ceramics again, and you can try to look at small details of what is happening in different areas, and you can come with different ideas to explain how the process of migration works. You can actually see the migration in the archaeological record. And this is what I have tried to do here. I have tried to offer you a better explanation for the ceramic development, considering the potter's field of action, which is basically potters that saw their possibilities enhanced just by being exposed to a lot of different influences from people from a lot of different places. So this is it. Thank you very much.